Grace, peace, and mercy is yours from the triune God. Amen. I bring you greetings today from your brothers and sisters in Christ at House for All Sinners and Saints. It's an unbelievable honor to be asked to be your preacher today. I'd like to thank the class of 2011 for asking me to be your preacher, and I'd like to thank God that I am able to give this sermon just under the eschatological wire. This week I posted a question on Facebook asking exactly when Pacific time the righteous are expected to float off with Mary Poppins. And I was assured that it wouldn't matter one bit, since, let's be honest, after the rapture, most of PLTS will still be around. So let's get to it. Perhaps, dear graduates, you are sitting here today wondering if you now have what it takes to serve this church that you love. Perhaps you're sitting here having listened to the lectures, perhaps defended your thesis, having survived the scrutiny of internship, and you are now thinking, am I prepared? Do I really have what it takes to serve the church as a pastor or a lay leader or a teacher? And the answer, of course, is don't be silly. Of course you don't. If you are worried that you have weaknesses and deficiencies and shortcomings, or as we recovering alcoholics like to call them, defects of character, you can stop worrying. You're right. You really don't have what it takes. But fortunately, you do have the God that it takes. And the question is not, will your failings and weaknesses and shortcomings get in the way? The question is, will your strengths get in the way? I think this is what we see in this parable of the great feast. A feast where the A-listers, the ones who supposedly have their game together, who own land and can buy oxen, the impressive folks. It is the totally invitable ones who make really lame excuses for not showing up. Oh, wow, a feast, huh? I'd love to be there, but my kids are in the highly gifted soccer league, aren't they? So the host sends his servants to instead call the poor, the lame, and the blind. And it's actually these riffraff, and not the A-listers, who sit at the table, gladly partaking of the feast set before them. See, sometimes it is the strong, able-bodied parts of us that fail to heed the invitation. My bishop said the greatest spiritual discipline is not praying the daily office or leading a vegan lifestyle. The greatest spiritual discipline is actually just showing up. See, those in our parable for today who were invited first were all able to actually come to the feast unaided. See, they were wealthy enough for horses and able-bodied enough to arrive on their own volition, and they didn't show up. Those who did come were those who could not get there without help. The blind needed guides, and the lame needed carrying if they were to make it to the feast. The same can be true of us. That the property-owning, healthy, secure parts of us can't always hear the invitation. Because sometimes we're so busy trying to be strong and self-sufficient and successful that we forget we're actually hungry. about the parts of us that are poor, the parts inside of us that are lame and that are blind. At least these parts of us know how we could use a good meal. And God invites those parts to dinner, because God will not be deterred by our excuses or our delusions of self-sufficiency. God sees where we are weak and hungry, even while we're trying to hide it from ourselves and from others. Most of you came to this commencement with real strengths for leadership. And I am certain these strengths will serve you and your students or your parishioners well. God will use your successes, to be sure. But if you really want to witness, if you really want to witness the handiwork of the Spirit, just watch how God will use your failures. Just wait till you glimpse the masterful redemption that springs forth when you ask forgiveness for having been a total jerk. And watch how grace will rush in to fill the spaces of these shortcomings. Because God reaches again and again into the graves we dig ourselves, continues to reach into our failures and yank out new life, just as God brought forth from the universe, from nothingness, and water from a rock, and babies from barren wombs, and a church from a bunch of forgiven sinners. So don't be afraid of your deficits, but rejoice in the spaces where you have nothing to offer. For this is the very canvas, the blank canvas on which God's best work is shown forth. Just wait. I promise you this. Not that long ago, when I was in seminary, I said, during discernment, I just want God to use me. And I've regretted it ever since. Because honestly, sometimes I feel used by God. See, embarking on Word and Sacrament ministry, I had some real strengths. I understood post-colonialism. I was a confessional Lutheran. I could distinguish law from gospel, patriarchy from womanism, and in pastoral care class, I learned how to tilt my head and show concern in my eyes while saying, "Tell me more about that." And while I'm not going to say these strengths were useless, I'm going to say that God has used my weaknesses a whole lot more. What God has really used in me are the things I'm no good at, where I have no choice but to ask for help. For example, and this might be shocking, but I'm not naturally a pastoral, nurturing, come to me, I'll listen to your problems kind of person. Naturally, I'm a slightly misanthropic, for the love of God, please stop whining kind of person. But I mention this for a reason, because the fact that I genuinely do care for all the folks in my church is only because I was forced to ask God for help in managing this impossible part of my job description. The fact that I sincerely have a deep fondness and concern and even love for all my parishioners can clearly only point to God's grace and mercy. I don't think, well, I'm just a better person now than I was before seminary. Trust me, I'm not. But see, God's strength is indeed perfected. Not in our strengths, but in our weaknesses, our poverty, and our hunger. And I simply cannot feel spiritual hunger pangs while I'm on the sugar high of personal charisma or graduate level education or economic privilege. It seems that only when those things fail me and I'm up against the limits of my personality or skill set that I then turn to God. And brothers and sisters, I'm here to report we have a faithful God. A God who will provide for God's people, even through you. A God who never tires of being for us what only God can be for us. A God who calls every part of us to the feast. So when you go from here to serve God's people, don't offer them only the invitable parts of yourself, your confidence and skill and intellect, but offer them also your weakness, your smallness, your blindness, and poverty. Offer them the blank spaces so that they may see God's creative mercy rushing in. For what I wish for you is this. Not that you might be strong and admirable and shiny in your ministries, but that God may use your weaknesses. May you continually die to self-sufficiency and rise to Christ. May your people see in you the work of a God who has always used the most questionable people to fulfill God's purpose. As you go from here, both prepared and unprepared for what awaits, may you, like the Apostle Paul, boast gladly in your weakness so that the power of Christ may dwell.